my privilege to serve as the 10th chair of the Board of Legal Services Corporation. As I said at lunch, we're so delighted to be here in Maine and home to your outstanding grantee, our outstanding grantee, Pine Tree Legal Assistance, and of course, Nan is just, I say, she's a national treasure. We'll be hearing about the important work of Pine Tree this afternoon. We'll also be here hearing remarks from Derek Langhauser, the chief counsel, general counsel of the governor, and Hancock lumber CEO Kevin Hancock, who's the 2016 recipient of the Muskie Access to Justice Award, such a strong voice for expanding justice access in Maine. Our program features two panels. The first brings together leaders from government, social services, and legal aid to discuss how Maine meets the needs of survivors of domestic violence and sexual assault. It will be moderated by LSC's vice chair and Harvard's 300th university professor, Martha Minow. Maine's attorney general, as well as a former chief justice, will join legal aid experts on the second panel, focusing on ways to ensure access to justice in rural Maine. LSC's outstanding, and I mean outstanding, and longest serving president, Jim Sandman, will moderate that panel. Well, we gather here today as LSC is in the process of rolling out two important, far-reaching reports, one on a crippling national problem that has hit Maine particularly hard, the opioid epidemic. Maine's rate of nearly 30 opioid deaths per 100,000 residents is unfortunately double the national rate, and was the sixth worst of 35 states, reporting data to the NIH in 2017. Well, our opioid task force, comprised of more than 30 leaders from legal and medical communities, federal and state government, veteran social services organizations, has made significant recommendations on how LSC and civil legal aid can work with other stakeholders in the medical, traditional law enforcement communities to deal more effectively with this challenge. Among its many findings, and incidentally, this is the report, there are copies out there, they're online, I expect everybody to read it. The report recognizes that civil legal aid providers are in a unique position to address the legal issues facing low-income people with opioid use disorder, especially when these providers partner with healthcare providers and other entities, such as youth organizations, social service organizations, faith-based organizations, schools, law enforcement, state agencies, family justice centers, and local peer recovery groups. Only by rallying and coordinating efforts from the many sectors of our society will we be successful in overcoming this national tragedy. Now, we first released the report just last month in June in Washington. We've had events in Chicago and Nashville since then. Two of the co-chairs of that task force, both members of the LSC board, are here with us today. Former ABA president, and you heard him at lunch, Robert Gray, Vic Maddox of Louisville's Fultz, Maddox & Dickens. The third co-chair, David Hoffman, is a partner of my firm, Sibley Austin, a non-director member of LSC's audit committee, and we're fortunate that our firm actually supported the work of this task force. Well, the final event marking the release will be held next week in San Francisco at the ABA's annual meeting. We did not prepare this report to have it just gather dust and sit on a shelf. So we at OSC will create an ongoing working group to follow and encourage progress on the report's important recommendations. And also at the ABA meeting, we will preview the release of our second task force's report, and that's the task force on disasters. This task force, composed of more than 60 leaders from the legal and medical communities. This task force has concluded its work and will release its findings on September 17th, you can mark that date, in Washington, with rollout events then in New York and the Midwest to follow. Two of the co-chairs of this task force are here with us today, Martha Menno and LSC Board Member Father Pius. The third co-chair is the former Chief Judge of the New York Court of Appeals, Jonathan Lippman, who's now of counsel to Latham & Watkins, and we're so grateful to that law firm for supporting the work of this task force. Then, on November 11th, the 100th anniversary of Veterans Day, LSC will continue another initiative by convening its second Veterans Day Summit in New York to highlight the importance of civil legal aid to this critical and underserved community. LSC and its grantees, none more important than Pine Tree Legal Assistance, assist veterans in a number of ways by establishing medical legal partnerships with veterans health centers, operating hotlines, taking part in special stand downs, and providing on-site legal help at veterans centers. LSC also regularly briefs Congress on these and related problems faced by veterans and how important it is that they have access to legal assistance. And LSC has supported since its launch in 2010 of Pine Tree's remarkable statesidelegal.org, the first national website focused on helping veterans and military families. It has become an invaluable resource to this community. Last year, this very site had more than 400,000 visitors, nearly 900,000 page views. But as we gather here today, we still have a long way to go to ensure access to justice for all. Unfortunately, nearly 59 million Americans qualify for LSC-funded civil legal assistance because they currently live at 125% of the federal poverty guideline or below. LSC's most recent study of the justice gap in 2017 found that an estimated 1 million civil legal problems brought to LSC grantees by low-income Americans in 2017 did not receive the legal assistance required to fully address their needs because of lack of resources. Well, earlier this year, LSC conducted a new intake census of its 132 grantees, and that suggests that the level of unmet need detected in 2017 continues. The 2019 intake census focused on financially eligible clients who sought legal assistance for civil legal problems at LSC grantees during a four-week period. It found that 42% of the legal problems presented received no response service of any kind, actually an increase of 1 percentage point from 2017. It also found that only 27% of the eligible problems presented were fully served. As our LSC board has visited now over half of the states during its tenure, we have heard repeatedly from chief justices, judges, state officials, grantees, and state after state that low-income individuals in matters of enormous consequence to them and their families, from housing to domestic violence, are unfortunately on their own without representation. The National Center for State Courts, in fact, reports that in almost 75% of civil cases in state courts, one or both parties are unrepresented. Studies also show that the represented parties have substantially higher success rates than those who are unrepresented. For example, in Virginia, win rates for represented defendants are 10 times those of unrepresented defendants in debt collection cases. 10 times. based on national statistics. In fact, there's only one legal aid lawyer for every approximately 10,000 client-eligible individuals to serve their legal needs. So is it any wonder that our grantees are forced to turn away so many people? Although Congress actually increased LSE's funding for fiscal year 2019 to $415 million, that figure is significantly below what's needed, even below the $420 million actually appropriated in 2010, less than half of what in today's dollars is the number I like to quote, that would be $880 million in inflation-adjusted dollars. That's the amount of the appropriation just 2 years after LSE's founding, in the 1970s. And at that time, only 12% of a smaller population qualified for LSE-funded assistance. Actually, even if Congress met LSE's fiscal year 2020 budget request for $593 million, and we still have hope, it would still be less in inflation-adjusted dollars than it was during many of the years of the Reagan administration. And this chronic underfunding of civil legal aid is much more than just another Washington budget battle over discretionary spending. There should be nothing discretionary about equal justice. I go around the country and say this. I don't believe equal justice is charity. I'm sure you don't either. Rather, as Justice Lewis Powell observed, it is one of the guiding principles of our democracy. That call for justice is in the preamble of our Constitution. On the facade of the Supreme Court, recited every day by our school children. Well, the country's first Chief Justice, John Marshall, recognized that liberty depends on access to justice. In Marbury versus Madison, you lawyers remember that case, he wrote, quote, "The very essence of civil liberty certainly consists in the right of every individual to claim the protection of the laws whenever he receives an injury. One of the first duties of government is to afford that protection," unquote. Ensuring access to justice is not simply a concern for judges and lawyers. It is a foundational civic duty for everyone, necessary to ensuring our democracy and the rule of law. This LSC board is committed to meeting this challenge, and we invite our fellow citizens across this country, both within and without the legal profession, to join in this effort. Thank you very much.